Welcome to the U.S. Department of State. This is Conversations with America, a discussion between top State Department officials and NGO leaders, where you can watch and participate in the exchange of ideas. With moderator Cheryl Benton, Deputy Assistant Secretary in the Bureau of Public Affairs.
Hello, I'm Cheryl Benton, Deputy Assistant Secretary in the Bureau of Public Affairs, and I'd like to welcome you to Conversations with America. Today, we are here to discuss building Americans' engagement with Sub-Saharan Africa. We'll address both the opportunities and the challenges that the U.S. government and non-governmental organizations face when partnering with Africa. Now let's introduce the experts that will be joining us for this discussion. We are privileged to have with us Ambassador Johnny Carson, Assistant Secretary in the Bureau of Public Affairs of African Affairs, Jennifer Cook, Director of the Africa Program at the Center for Strategic and International Studies, and John Norris, Executive Director of the Sustainable Security at the Center for American Progress. Thank you all so much for participating in today's program.
Thank you.
In July of 2009, President Obama gave a speech to the Ghanaian parliament calling for a partnership with Africa that is grounded in mutual responsibility and mutual respect. His administration has continued to pursue this goal, and in June of 2012, the president signed a new presidential policy directive with respect to U.S. policy towards sub-Saharan Africa. Its vision and principles have been distilled into the U.S. strategy towards sub-Saharan Africa. Ambassador Carson, could you start us off by providing an overview of this very important policy directive initiated by President Obama?
Cheryl, thank you very much for inviting me to this important program today. The President, as you pointed out, asked the Department of State to work with the National Security Council staff to assess the policies that we have been pursuing in Africa since the beginning of the administration, to review them and to determine whether they remained relevant for us over the next 3 or 4 years. As a result of that review, we did in fact complete an assessment in which we said that the U.S. government should follow four strategic pillars. The first was to strengthen democratic institutions and to promote democracy and good governance. The second pillar was to do everything that we could to spur market-driven, free market-driven economic policies to encourage greater trade and investment by the United States in Africa, and to help Africa strengthen its own economic foundations, develop its industries and its agriculture and its economies. The third pillar was to do everything that we could to promote peace and security around the African continent. As people well know, instability, civil war, civil strife destroys the lives of people, undermines economic development, and robs countries and citizens of opportunity. And so the third pillar was to do as much as we could to continue our efforts to promote peace and stability. The fourth pillar was to help Africa deal with its development issues. And behind that was a very explicit commitment by the administration to continue to strengthen Africa's agriculture through the Feed the Future program to work with African governments to improve their health, to address issues of HIV, AIDS, malaria, cholera, and tuberculosis through the Global Health Initiative. But those are the four basic pillars that were outlined in the strategy. And they build off of the president's speech in July of 2009 to the Ghanaian parliament. And they build off a number of speeches and commitments that have been made since then by Secretary of State Hillary Clinton. But those pillars are the things that we're focused on. And I certainly can go into greater detail about how we've attempted to implement those right. pillars in the past and what we will be doing in the future.
Okay, very good. I'll go first to John and then to Jennifer to ask you if you would both talk a little bit about your roles at CAP and your role at CSIS and how your work relates to this initiative.
Sure. The Sustainable Security Program at CAP really looks at how we can make America's instruments of international engagement more effective, particularly mm-hmm. in a place like Africa. How we can shore up peace processes, how we can shift to an approach that is more built around crisis prevention rather than response, and try to get the balance right between those instruments that America relies on in terms of defense, in terms of diplomacy, in terms of doing those basic things that would help the United States be a little less reliant on a military approach right. to the world, and finding and realizing that diplomacy and development are usually a little more cost effective and can advance our interests just as well if used properly.
Very good. Jennifer?
Yeah, I mean, in fact, CSIS Africa program, the priorities are very similar to the pillars that mm-hmm. Ambassador Carson laid out: governance, security, trade and investment, and development. You know, there's a tendency to paint Africa with a very broad brush and see it as a monolith. And one of the things we try to do is to kind of convey and try to understand the specific political, economic, social context of particular countries, particular regions. Mm-hmm. And, you know, what is it that's stymieing good governance? What are the levers for reform? Who are the constituencies for reform? What are the vulnerabilities that maybe we're not seeing? You know, where are the opportunities for U.S. influence? Mm-hmm. You know, how does the U.S. How might the U.S. calibrate its diplomatic, security, development engagement in them? So, kind of trying to get across, I think, a little bit more nuanced understanding of the countries at hand. We're doing more and more on trade and investment because I think this is a huge opportunity right. in Africa in the future, and there we're looking at. You know, some of the positive stories, how are African entrepreneurs or African governments or businesses untangling some of these long-standing barriers to investment and helping encourage U.S. investors to look more seriously at Africa? And then how might the U.S. kind of leverage the business sector's development impact and make that kind of inclusive growth that we're talking about? And just a final word, one of the things we really try to do is integrate into all of these efforts African perspectives and highlight African voices here in Washington, make sure their views, the debates that are going on within Africa are well understood here in Washington.
Very good. In what areas does President Obama expect a greater involvement with Sub-Saharan Africa?
Let me say that we believe that Africa is the last global economic frontier, and that Africa offers an enormous amount of promise and potential as a major trading partner, as a place for Americans to invest and do substantially much more business than they are doing right now. We want to put an expanded emphasis on trade, investment, in order to encourage more American companies to look at the prospects of doing business in Africa, but also recognizing that there is a mutuality of interest, and that this trade and investment will help to spur real economic growth in Africa with the development of its agriculture, not just to end household famine and food shortages, but to help African countries develop agro-industry,
exactly,
where they can make money off of this, and to work with African countries to develop their enormous potential in electricity, hydroelectric power, gas-driven power, solar and natural energy-driven power, to help them develop their industries, to build their infrastructure. And so we believe that there is an enormous opportunity for mutual interest in developing the economies. Secretary Clinton this August took a trade mission to South Africa, took a number of leading American companies and their leadership to South Africa to help introduce them to the potential in the African market, not only in South Africa, but in the broader region. This past February, I took some 12 American companies to a number of countries, Tanzania, Mozambique, Ghana, and Nigeria, to look at the enormous potential that exists for American companies in the area of generation and transmission and distribution of electricity, something that Africa is short on. This is something good for the United States. We have a lot to offer in this area, but it's also enormously important for Africa. If Africa is going to make that next major leap forward, it needs to develop its energy. So we think there's enormous potential. Focus will be increasingly on economic commercial issues, and we think this is mutually beneficial for the continent and also for America.
Very good. Curious, does Sub-Saharan Africa hold strategic interest for the United States? And if so, you know, what are they?
Well, I certainly agree with the ambassador's point that Africa is just an area of incredible economic dynamism right now, and I think every economist, every foreign policy expert rightly points to that being one of the undertold stories of Africa right now. So there's the economic side, but I think there's a real threat on the economic side as well, and a real challenge. I think one of the economic challenges that's particularly tricky for the United States government is that a lot of the economic obstacles in Africa to even more impressive growth are those barriers between states. And I think Secretary Clinton has been very forceful in conversations with African heads of states. They need to do a better job making it so that it doesn't take several days to get a truck from the interior of Africa to the coast to deal with some of those tariffs and customs issues that are very pedestrian, very annoying, but hugely influential in how you do trade. And at the same time, the other threat on economic dynamism is also another area of security interest for the United States, is there's a whole swath of Africa right now, kind of from Mali over to Somalia right now, that is very vulnerable right now for a variety of reasons, everything from the weather to internal conflicts to extremism, and it's a very complex map and portrait right now. But I think there's a real risk that if we don't get the crisis prevention right across that broad swath, it has a real potential to undermine peace and security, as well as a lot of the economic dynamism that we hope to see over the next generation.
Good. And Jennifer, from your perspective, how does this work for CSI, and how do you see this playing out?
Well, I think the security threats are very real. Mm-hmm. You know, the narcotics trafficking, violent extremism, internal conflicts that are devastating in terms of their human impact. You know, in a globalized world, all of these things matter. What happens in Africa matters much more to the United States than perhaps, you know, 20 years ago,
exactly,
what have you. So there's the threat aspect of this. I think the economic opportunity is I think the other interest to the United States. I'm kind of losing track of the question.
That's okay. we're trying to figure out what areas do you see opportunity for potential collaboration with the U.S. government and Africans?
Yeah, well, I think, we do a lot of collaboration mm-hmm. already in the security realm, working with African partners on that. I think that's extremely important that
exactly.
the U.S. is not just go in and do things according to its agenda, but it be working with African partners on that. I think we do have to work with African governments to help encourage investment, to ensure that that investment is being used to generate employment, mm-hmm. to generate development, to kind of so that it's not concentrated, wealth is not concentrated in the hands of
a few. With the hands of a few, right.
And there, I think more and more in a globalized world, we need to partner with African governments on the big global issues of the day. Whether it's nuclear proliferation, climate change, the trade regime, even the big norms, democracy, human rights, responsibility to protect, as multilateral institutions become more important, the U.S. needs partners in alliances in those realms as well.
And it's also an era when it's not just a question of what is Africa's impact on us, what is our impact on Africa?
Right.
That we're now in a society in a time when Europe's economic slowdown has real implications for economic growth in Africa. What are we doing with our own trade preferences?
Mm-hmm.
What are we doing in our own farm bill? These have shockwaves that radiate out towards Africa. So I think we've entered an age when we are genuinely interdependent in a lot of ways that people don't necessarily appreciate.
Oh, I appreciate it myself. And that leads to our next question. How can the U.S. promote and assist the participation of American small and medium size enterprises in partnerships with African entrepreneurs and businesses? And, you know, I think that has a lot of relevance because we look at what China is doing over there. And I realize it's a race to the top, and we've got to be in that mix. So I was wondering how that plays out.
Well, let me say that the administration continues to focus on the importance of AGOA, the African
yes.
Growth and Opportunity Act, which allows for some 5,000 plus products to come in to the United States duty-free from Africa. AGOA has been in existence for 12 years,
right.
And we believe that under AGOA, based on what we've seen, a large number of African entrepreneurs, a large number of African countries have taken increasing benefit from the ability to access our market. Many of these companies that are doing so are small companies that become medium-sized companies, and we hope
mm-hmm.
will become larger companies. These companies are sending in textiles, clothing. They're sending in shoes and leather manufactured
mm-hmm.
Objects. They're sending in some machine parts and tools.
Mm-hmm.
And countries like South Africa are taking large advantage in sending in even some types of commercial vehicles into the U.S. marketplace.
Okay.
But most African businesses are in the small to medium-sized category. But to assist and to make this more relevant to Africa's small and medium-sized businesses, we have done a number of things in the last 3 years
okay.
under this administration to engage and involve both Africans and Americans at the small, medium, and large sector. One of the things we've done is to create a program that we call AWEP, African Women's Entrepreneurial Program, where we have, in association with AGOA, sought to work with groups of African women entrepreneurs to help them to improve the quality of their products so that they reach our standards,
mm-hmm.
to improve their marketing so that they can advertise in their products to the U.S., and their access by helping them to get to the buyers in the United States who are going to buy. Mm-hmm. And this is bringing them to marketing shows in the United States, helping them to access large commercial dealers here, whether it is working with Diane von Furstenberg on the fashion side, mm-hmm. or working with Walmart on the large retail side. Mm-hmm. We've been able to help them do that. Become a very much a part of our program, and so AWEP is very good.
Oh, wow.
We've had 30 to 40 women participating in events over the last 3 years, and the secretary is pushed this very hard. The other thing,
I would say that is the first time I've heard Diane von Furstenberg and Walmart in the same sentence. I'm very impressed.
I hope that that Walmart accepts some of her fashion.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
But the other thing that we've done, I think, which has been critically important, and it shows again this mutuality. That this is good for the United States, and it's good for Africa. 2010 was the anniversary of the African Growth and Opportunity mm-hmm. Act, and as a part of that, we instituted something very new that is we hope will continue to go forward in future years. Instead of just having a meeting between U.S. government officials in commerce, the U.S. Trade Representative's Office, Export-Import Bank, OPIC, and the Department of State, we decided to cut the Washington component of the AGOA conference down to half of what it was.
Okay.
So instead of spending a week in Washington with government officials, talking to government officials,
right.
we decided to take the program to the field. And so in 2010, we did 2.5 days in Washington and then 2.5 days in Kansas. And
right.
we invited ministers as well as a group of African businessmen and women, plus the AWEP participants, to join us in Kansas to look at every aspect of American agriculture, to help network, mm-hmm. to help build relationships, to pass off knowledge, and to expose Africans to the full range of our agriculture, and to expose American companies such as Cargill and Monsanto and Pioneer mm-hmm. and others to what exists as opportunities in the agricultural field here. And so it was about seeds, it was about mm-hmm. Fertilizers, it was about storage mm-hmm. facilities, it was about improved non-rain-fed watering systems. It was about equipment and how you improve your crops. But it brought African businessmen and women and government officials into a contact with what America is all
right.
about, that farming sector and industry. In 2012, again in the United States, coming back, we did the same thing. 2.5 days in Washington, and then we took this summer African officials out to Cincinnati to let them take a look at our
That's
energy,
great.
Our energy sector, our sanitation
mm-hmm.
sector, and our infrastructure sector, exposing them to the work of Duke Energy and major players like that, GE. And others who are doing work across the board, but people saw how we our energy sector works, is powered, how reliable it is, plus our water and sanitation systems. We have the best, cleanest mm-hmm. water system in the world here, and it's no reason why we can't sell that technology to Africa, which would benefit from it by having cleaner water, healthier communities, and stronger societies. And so it was mutually. We will continue to do that. These are ways to do it. Again, we are working also with SBA to involve them so that they can help show government officials how we support small business and give them ideas, and we expose them to African business people so that they can encourage their governments to do things like this as well.
Yeah, that's pretty neat. Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I think the big thing is exposure. The perceptions of risks in Africa that businesses here have are often much higher than the actual risk, and so that kind of exposure, exposing people to the kind of opportunities and gaps that might exist is very important. I think a lot of the bigger businesses, China's engagement in Africa, for all that it can be a little controversial, has piqued the interest of a lot of big businesses here, saying, wait a second, they're doing well. There are opportunities for us here. So that kind of exposure to opportunities, to the diversity of Africa as well, is important. In terms of empowering African small and medium enterprise, again, does the growth that we're seeing kind of bring up all boats in that?
Right.
And I think it's important that these small businesses have access to credit and access to financial services, that small farmers get access to kind of improved seeds, improved technologies, so you move from a hand hoe to an ox or to a tractor. And are the government policies within those countries encouraging small and medium enterprises in that way? In this regard, there's new technologies that are transforming the African landscape in that way. And mobile telephony allows the small farmer to check market prices and see if it's worth making the trip to the capital. That you can transfer money. There's mobile banking now. All of these things, I think, if expanded and invested in, can help bring up the very small and medium enterprises within Africa, so that the wealth is not concentrated
in just a few. And just changing that whole paradigm of how you approach AGOA, I'm sure has made a world of difference to those companies in Africa, as well as what we are able to offer them from America. We've received questions on today's topic. We've gotten one, Frederick, who sent something in on Twitter. How does the U.S. plan to engage Africa differently than India, China, EU, and France? I didn't let anyone take that.
This goes to a follow-up to what Jennifer was saying. In understanding the right atmosphere and environment for American trade compared to China, China's model in Africa right now, and a lot of places in the developing world, is a mercantile model. It's kind of America 1880s. They're interested in the natural resources. They're interested in securing a relationship with a government in power, pretty much regardless of the composition or characteristics of that government. And it is driven by their need for natural resources to feed their economic boom at home, which is slowing down to a certain extent. The enabling environment for American companies, European companies, is one built on good governance, transparency, regularity, the rule of law, very different characteristics.
Right.
And so I think the things that the ambassador and Jennifer have talked about in terms of getting exposure for medium and small businesses is really important, but the big picture will continue to be getting the policy environment right. Private capital in the United States and Europe is very nimble. It's very smart. Mm-hmm. It will go places where it figures out that there is an acceptable level of risk and a good playing field for them. And if we can get some of those big picture things about governance and transparency and cross-border trade right, American capital will flow, and I think a lot of small and medium-sized entrepreneurs in Africa will do very well as a result.
Very good.
Just on that, on the trade and investment side, I mean, I think even the U.S. private sector is much more constrained than, say, the Chinese by anti-corruption laws, and so it has to operate in a transparent way. The brand, the reputation of the U.S. private sector. U.S. companies tend to do a lot more training, knowledge transfer, technology transfer than some other countries. And I think so. There's an advantage that if countries recognize to kind of greater U.S. engagement on that front. One thing that I think really differentiates the U.S. from China, in particular in India, is that our engagement goes much beyond the government of the day, and it's much beyond
gotcha.
Commercial. We do a lot more with civil society, gotcha. With community groups. I think we have a much better ear for public opinion mm-hmm. and kind of trends within the country. China obviously has a kind of non-interference policy. That's not its domain. That's not what it's going to deal with. I think it's an advantage for the United States in some ways because Africa is changing. There are
yes.
more voices in the political marketplace. You have to listen to civil society. You have to listen to opposition groups. And I think that's, you know, the U.S., you know, has a much kind of broader gauge in engagement than I think China or in India.
Absolutely.
I think it's important to remember that our engagement with Africa is driven by fundamental principles,
yes.
values, and historical interests and relationships.
Right.
And that as we engage Africa, we should engage Africa based on our values and principles,
that's right.
Which are fundamental to our own interests here at home.
Mm-hmm.
And that as we engage Africa, we should not be engaging Africa because someone else is,
mm-hmm.
or because they mm-hmm. are seen to be competing with us.
Mm-hmm.
We should be engaging with Africa because we believe there is an intrinsic value and importance in doing so. That we recognize that historically we have a large African-American population
right.
whose origin is African, that we have economic interests that tie us together. We have Nigeria, for
mm-hmm.
example, which is the fifth largest supplier of crude oil to the United States, the largest supplier of low sulfur and crude oil, and supplies as much fuel to us on a daily basis as Saudi Arabia. We have to remember that American corporations are dominant players in the oil industry, not
That's
only
right.
in Nigeria, but in Angola
yes.
and Algeria and in new explorations in Liberia. And we also have to remember that it is our fundamental democratic values and principles, our respect for constitutional civilian democratic governance that protects the rights of citizens as well as the rights of corporations. It's our judicial system. It's our values and principles
mm-hmm.
that should be leading our way, and that is what keeps us engaged
mm-hmm.
in Africa. It's not the apprehension of competition with Great Britain or France or Germany or with the new entrants, China and Turkey and Brazil and India. We have interests that have been longstanding
Absolutely.
That we need to continue to encourage. Those players may be ephemeral. They
mm-hmm.
may come and they may go, but our interests should remain permanent. Our engagement should be based on those interests. And I think, Jennifer, you're absolutely right. When it comes to China versus Africa, there is no question in my mind that African countries ought to look very carefully at the enormous differences
Yes.
that exist between engaging with an American company and engaging with a Chinese company. And we do have differences that are stark and that are quite real. We have transparency. We have a Foreign Corrupt Practices Act that ensures that transparency. And you, when you deal with us, you know, as you said, there's technology transfer, there's training, there's participation in a global market, there's respect for local laws. We hire locally. We don't bring in thousands of workers. We respect environmental codes and we respect local law. And when we run afoul of both a contract with laborers and a contract with corporations, it can be adjudicated not only in the host country, but in our country as well, as we've seen. You know, people don't talk very frequently about the Chinese justice system. They don't talk about Chinese transparency. They don't talk about Chinese hiring lots of local labor. They don't talk about Chinese following environmental standards. And we don't see Africans going off to Beijing for further training and then being dispatched to Germany, France, or another African company to represent a Citibank or to represent a Chevron or to represent Coca-Cola or Pepsi-Cola or Boeing or any of the others. We have a difference. And the other thing we have to do as a part of this is to say to African countries that they have a responsibility in dealing not only with China, but with India and Brazil and Turkey and other countries and us, to live up to the same set of standards.
That's right.
You know, let's not have a different standard for one major company or power and a different standard for another. If you've got an unemployment problem as well as an infrastructure problem, don't bring in 10 or 20,000 workers to produce a bridge or a road that falls apart in
or a soccer stadium
that falls apart in two or 3 years and then not employ anyone in the process. There's a real difference, and I think we need to do that. But fundamentally, we engage with Africa because we have real, tangible interests that are historical, long-standing, and are based on both social, economic, and political reasons.
Yeah, that's very good.
We're there for a reason that goes beyond competition.
That's very true. So what steps can we take, and this is another question that came in on Twitter, to help end violence, especially gender-based violence, in the Democratic Republic of the Congo? And I just will add, the Secretary's visited there. She's very strong on holding these leaders accountable, particularly around the gender-based violence. I mean, that's such, it's very important to me, too. It's close to my heart and soul.
Let me just say, we are committed to fighting gender-based violence, and we're particularly committed to trying to fight it in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, where it has become a huge scourge in the East. And we have a number of programs that we're engaged in. One is that we are constantly encouraging the government to arrest and prosecute and punish those individuals who are involved. We are helping through a number of programs to train more magistrates to be able to try cases of gender-based violence. We are encouraging the government through training programs to give their police officers and their military officers the recognition and awareness that they need to have to respect the rights of women and to not carry out deprivations and attacks against women themselves, and to put this as a part of their key training. We're also trying to have more women in the police force, more women magistrates, and more women who are trained to deal with these issues in the in the military, and it is a combination of trying to, on the one hand, encourage prosecution and punishment, mm-hmm. On the other, of building up institutional awareness among those who should have it, and to train and to insert into key places women who can represent the issues of women and raise awareness and training. All of these things are things that we're committed to doing. But let me say, it is an enormous problem. It is an enormous problem, and I would be the first to admit that we have not been able to get our hands around it. There is still far too much sexual and gender-based violence occurring throughout the Democratic Republic of the Congo, but particularly in the East, and we need to make our voices constantly heard at a loud level on this, and we need to encourage others in the international community to have their voices heard as well.
Yeah, we're running up on time, but I did want to get your comment on that as well as yours.
Just very quickly, the violence against women in the Eastern Congo is, they're symptoms of a much larger mm-hmm. problem, and I think two problems primarily. One, that Congo hasn't gotten to the point where it can effectively defend its sovereignty. That we continue to have a problem of the Lord's Resistance Army moving around fluidly. We continue to have problems with Rwandan and Rwandan influences mm-hmm. moving in and out of the East pretty easily. I think the U.S. government should be congratulated for moving against Kony and the Lord's Resistance Army, and I think for toughening up its position a little bit with Rwanda and making clear that continued incursions will carry some diplomatic costs. Then the other problem is the even broader one that Congo struggles with in terms of the rule of law mm-hmm. and security sector reform. Mm-hmm. And we're not going to fix violence against women as long as police and army officials are part of that problem.
Gotcha.
You know, and those are enormous long-term endeavors, and that's not something the United States can do by itself. It needs its partners in the European Union and elsewhere in Africa to help with, but that is a long, slow slog.
Sure. Jennifer?
Well, John took the words out of my mouth. I mean, it's the most horrific symptom of what's fundamentally a governance problem in Kinshasa, and, you know, accountable and competent security forces that can protect women and that don't engage themselves in the predations, the rule of law, accountability, ending impunity. It's going to be very hard to get our arms around it in a comprehensive way if you don't have the political will within the government to both on this particular issue, but on the broader insecurity and the vacuum of governance in Eastern Congo. And that's a tricky
one of the things that I noted that the ambassador has taught me is that in addition to what we do internationally and in America, the future of Africa is up to Africans. And so that as the basis, you know, maybe we can move this agenda forward. But this is my least favorite part of the show. It's time to close. And I wanted to thank you, Ambassador Carson, and like to know if you could please share your final thoughts with us, and then we'll close this out.
I remain very optimistic about Africa's future. I think that democratic progress continues to be made. I think Africa is realizing that it has an enormous economic and commercial future, and is making progress there. We will continue to work, as President Obama said, with Africa on the basis of deep mutual respect and mutual responsibility.
Right, good. Jennifer, could you share your final thoughts with us?
Yeah, I mean, I think you summed it up well, that, you know, we can influence and we can help, and we can support African governments, and we can help support constituencies for reform and for pushing better governance, better economic opportunity. We have to be, you know, realistic about the limits of U.S. influence. Ultimately, this will reside in the hands of African governments and African citizens, and we want to make sure that their voice and that they're empowered and that their voice is heard.
Very good, John.
Yeah, I would just say I think it's a fantastically exciting time in that we're starting to treat Africa the way that we've treated every other region in the world. That, you know, it's not a problem in Asia that you can have a Singapore and an Afghanistan together. It doesn't mean that all of Asia is a wild success or wild failure. We're getting away from looking at Africa as a single entity, that we are understanding that there are great economic and political reformers and dynamos that we can work with, and other places that are problems and issues that we need to mitigate and resolve. And I think that that sense of nuance and that sense of the maturation of the relationship is a really vital step forward.
Dynamo versus dinosaur. Okay, I'd like to thank Ambassador Johnny Carson, Jennifer Cook, and John Norris for sharing their work and knowledge with us. I'd also like to thank each of you for joining us today. We hope that Conversations with America will continue to inform citizens about the administration's efforts to address the challenges of the 21st century. We look forward to engaging with you again soon. Thank you.